Our next scripture is taken from Deuteronomy 8, verses 17 through 18. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your ancestors, as it is today. I want to start out with a story. And it's the story of a woman, an older woman, who had just finished her shop. And she had returned to her car and she found four men inside her car. She immediately dropped her shopping bags, pulled a big gun out of her purse, and with a forceful voice she said, I have a gun and I know how to use it. Get out of the car. Well, and of course, those men didn't even wait for a second invitation. They just took off down the parking lot. And so the lady, she was a little bit shaken about this, and so she threw her bags in the back seat real quick and got into the car, and she just wanted to get out of there as fast as she could. But no matter how hard she tried, she couldn't get her key to go in the ignition. Then it hit her. This isn't my car. She looked around, and sure enough, about four or five spaces away was her car. So she got out, she looked around to make sure the men weren't there, and she hurriedly loaded her bags into her own car. And then she drove herself to the police station and turned herself in. The desk sergeant, after hearing her story, just started laughing uncontrollably and just about fell out of his chair. He pointed to the other end of the counter where four men were reporting a carjacking by a woman with glasses, curly white hair, less than 5 feet tall, and a big gun. Well, needless to say, no charges were filed. You know, she thought it was her car, but really belonged to someone else. And the truth is, it's the same way with us. God owns everything. He owned that lady's car that day, and he owned the one that she got into by mistake. And he owns everything that we call ours. He owns it all. When David, in Scripture, in Psalms, is talking about wealth and everything, there's a scripture that he relates to from Haggai, and it says, the silver and gold belong to me. And this is the declaration of the Lord of hosts. In the New Testament, Paul himself notes that God not only owns the world and its wealth, but God owns us as well. God owns us as well. In 1 Corinthians 6:19, it says, do you not know that your body is a sanctuary of the Holy Spirit who is within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own. You know, sometimes when we go into a motel, especially when you get older like I am, I look around for somebody to carry my bags to my room. And a lot of times it's my wife. But, you know, that steward or that bellhop or whoever it is that takes your bags and who takes them up into your room, he knows that those are not his. You entrust them to that person just for a time, trusting that he will return them to you. And that's kind of the foundation I want to talk about today. The overall part of this is God owns it all. He's the owner of everything. So what does that tell us about our relationship to God and the stuff that he entrusts to us? If I believe that I'm the owner of what I possess, then I'm going to be constantly in conflict with God. Him and I are going to be fighting all the time over what I am going to do with the things I have. That I word sneaks in there in so much of Scripture. But when I take the minute to step back and understand that the Lord, our God, is the owner, and I am just that manager, that bellhop, the conflict disappears and freedom overtakes our lives. It just gives us wonderful freedom to know that God's going to take care of this. It's all His anyway. So I want to stop for just a second before I go any further. I want to give you all a test. You know, if you go off to work this week and make $400, okay? And you come to church on Sunday, I want to ask you today, how much of that $400 belongs to God? You know, and I can see some of you on a piece of paper. I've done the same thing in the past. You know, I looked at, well, let me see, 10% of 400, that's $40. No. That's not what we're looking at today. The principle of tithing does not mean that $40 is God's and the rest is yours. It all belongs to God. Every last penny of it belongs to God. In 1 Corinthians 4:7, it says, "For who makes you so superior? What do you have that you didn't receive?" Those are important words, because oftentimes what we receive, we boast about, just like we haven't received it. That's an important part of today's message. Those questions are easy answers. What makes us so superior? Not a thing in the world. You know, and should we boast about it? Again, easy answer. No. Deuteronomy, which I just quoted from, also cautions again. It says, "You may say to yourself, my power and my own ability have gained this wealth for me." But remember, it's the Lord your God that gave you that power and ability to begin with. These are such easy concepts to understand, just like faith that you mentioned, Dale. They're so easy to understand, but we don't. We continually fight God over what supposedly is ours and what is His. So, we go back again to King David. King David at one time was probably the most powerful man on earth. And after receiving a tremendous offering, David responded to God. He said, "But who am I and who are my people that we should be able to give as generously as this? For everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your own hand." There were many times where Paul wrote to many churches that he ministered to, and many of these churches were so poor. Beyond, they had nothing. And yet through their belief and their true faith, that poverty overflowed into generosity. They gave themselves, and they gave themselves to God's will. Some people do. Unlike these churches, they use poverty as an an excuse not to give. And they miss out on that feeling of generosity, that freedom that comes. You know, in the Bible, and we've heard this many times, God loves a cheerful giver. Joyful giving is a sign that the givers understand who is the owner and who is the manager. Those givers that understand that are invested in heaven. And that reaps eternal dividends. You know, once when the tabernacle was being built, many of the workers came and complained that they're bringing too much. They're bringing too much. We have too much. And so Moses gave an order and sent out a proclamation. Said, don't bring any more. We have sufficient for our needs. There is more than enough. That is the example, a true, abundant, joyful giving. So, let's go on a little further. If I am accountable to God because He is the owner, He has expectations of me, and He has expectations of you. He has a right to a full disclosure, when we get into legal terms, of what has been done with his property. Our managing of that property that he gives us is going to undergo one of these days a performance evaluation. The owner is going to check on a number of things. He's not only going to check on what he has given us, but in the words of Paul in Romans, he says, by the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual worship. Paul says a proper and spiritual act of worship is to give yourself fully to Christ to be used as his servant. I'm getting a little long this morning, but this is an important message, and I just want you to understand some of the things that God's going to examine when he calls us forward as his steward. He's going to ask us to look at ourselves. He's going to ask us, how devoted have you been to me? He's going to look at our possessions. He's going to say, what with you? What have you done with those possessions that I've given to you? What have you done with it? I want an accounting. He's going to look at our time because, you know what? Time is as precious as money. What did we do with our time? Did we waste anything in those 24 hours a day that he gives us? People don't always think that is a wealth that he gives. He's going to look at our abilities. I've given you all these abilities. Have you used them or not? Or are you sitting there not hearing my call and wasting your ability? He's just given us so much to manage. But we will be called into accounting. You know, before I conclude this, in your bulletin today, your pledge sheet. I ask that you prayerfully consider those and return them to us. Hopefully by the end of the month, this is what we base our budget on for the church this year. And that's why it is so important. I want to draw your attention back to the two quotes that are on the front of your bulletin this morning. Mother Teresa, if you give what you do not need, it isn't given. Also, from Martin Luther, I have tried to keep things in my hands and lost them all. But what I have given into God's hands, I still possess. So if God came before you tonight and gave you that examination and asked for an accounting this very night, what would he have to say about your giving? Would it reflect a humble belief that we are only managing what is his? Would joy and cheer mark our lives when he came before us? That we know because of what we have given is gaining infinite treasure for us. Infinite, holy, and heavenly treasure. So let's think about how we are spending our resources for Christ and his kingdom. You know that old white-haired lady that I was talking about at the first of the sermon? She was mistaken as she went to the wrong car. When she pulled out a gun and sent those four scurrying across the parking lot, but hers was an honest mistake. It wasn't her car. And she wasn't held accountable for her actions. But we will be held accountable. All that we call ours is actually his. My prayer today is that we will, that we do properly manage what God has entrusted to us. Amen.
Amen.
Now the last song as we sing for this